So hello everyone, once again, thank you so much for joining today's session. It's a great pleasure to have you today. Thanks so much for joining even before time. I really do appreciate that you've been able to keep time and we are really ready for the session. Thank you so for much for also introducing yourselves in the chat box. I'll just beg once the session starts, we can pause a bit so that at least we don't have a lot of interruptions coming in. But thank you so much. So because I can see already a good number, I would love us to start so that we don't take so much time and we don't waste so much time. So I'd love by introducing our guest speaker for the day. That's Dr. Eva Garmendia, who is the project coordinator at Uppsala Antibiotic Center. I'm sure you can all see her, and she's experienced in management and communication and specialized in antibiotic resistance. And she's a microbiology scientist who has a strong interest in science communication, network building, and facilitation within science. Interestingly, Dr. Eva had previously been working on various research topics within genetics and evolution at the University of Granada, the Spanish Research Council, and the Uppsala University. And she did a PhD in medical sciences with a focus on bacterial evolution, which she defended in 2017. So as shared, she's currently the coordinator of Uppsala Antibiotic Center, where she's in charge of the overall project management, content creation, communication, and networking. And I think what I really know about Eva, even though she doesn't know this, I'm sure she's really a great fan and a great enthusiast of science communication. And a fan of the podcast. The center really has a good podcast. They have shared so many sessions. They'll be sharing this with us too, maybe as the session continues. So they have really a lot of podcasts, and they really share a lot of interesting information on AMR. So with that, I would love to maybe welcome Dr. Eva to today's session. Thank you so much. We really do appreciate having you with us today. And wow, you can try and share your screen and yes, then we can start right off. Thank you so much.
I'll do that. Thank you so much, Daniel. Thank you. I'm very pleased to be here. I see that this 56 people. I'm very honored and surprised that there is so many people here. I hope that I have some insights to share with you and that you can take something with you home, or if you're already home, something with you from this meeting today. I'm going to share my screen to share the presentation that I'll be presenting today. Let me see. Can you confirm with me that you are seeing my presentation?
Yes, it's visible, Eva. Yeah,
it is visible. Okay, let me see. Spotlight for everybody. All right. Correct. Perfect. All right. So as Daniel was mentioning today, I work for the Uppsala Antibiotic Center. I'm a coordinator and I guess partially a communicator also there. And although I do not do research on AMR communication in particular, I do have a little bit of experience on preparing communications efforts around AMR. So he invited me to come here and talk to you about some of the best practices and some examples that draw from my own experience as well. Here you have some of the ways that you can connect with me. If after this you want to somehow write to me or say something, you can either connect with me through Twitter, you can send me emails directly, or you can get a lot of information about our center in our website, uac.uu.se. All right, so let's get into it. Today we have about an hour approximately together till 7, and I have decided to divide the session in a little bit different parts. So first we're going to work together into finding why should we communicate about AMR. We are all here, all of you 62 people, 61 without me, 63 coming up, are here because you want to learn about communications in AMR. And my question is, why do we have to communicate about AMR at all? We're going to talk about some basic communication tips, some touching up a little bit also into strategic communication and how can we use the principles of strategic communication into the communications on AMR. We are going to talk a little bit about the importance of target audiences. We are going to talk about the ways and the channels that we can use to communicate on AMR. And then we're going to dive very deep into the report by the Welcome on reframing resistance, because it has a lot of good research and very good results on things that we can apply when we are working on presenting AMR concepts to different audiences. And at the end, I'm going to just show you the examples on the communication efforts that we've been doing. I've been working with directly at the Uppsala Antibiotic Center. Does that work well for you guys? I hope that you are ready for this ride with me. All right. So I guess first I have to introduce myself. Danielle did a very wonderful example of saying who I am and why am I here, but I still wanted to make the case of like, why is it that it's me today talking to you about this? As he said, I have a PhD in medical sciences. So some of you, I believe you are tertiary students. You might go on and do some research. I spent 5 years in the lab, a lot of 5 years, more than those 40 hours a week in the lab and doing experiments. This photo that you can see here on the left is from my last big experiment before I defended my PhD. But during my PhD and my undergrad years, I also was engaged in a lot of efforts on communicating science, not AMR in particular. Perhaps I was talking about AMR here and there, but it wasn't the topic of my thesis. So I was talking more about bacteria in general. And I loved going out and talking to people about the wonders of the bacterial world and trying to synthesize information that I thought was important for kids, young students, families to know out there and trying to say, why should they even care about knowing these details about the bacterial world? I guess. Daniel, if there's any questions in the chat, I of course welcome them. So if I'm not going to be monitoring the chat, but if you see something that you need to stop me to cover, please do so. Okay, Daniel, just take care of
that. Yes.
For me. Perfect.
Yes, I'm doing the chat.
No, yes, great. Thank you so much. When I finished my PhD, I decided that I didn't want to continue doing research, but I still wanted to be close to science and I wanted to work in the topic of antimicrobial resistance, antibiotic resistance, because it was very important in my eyes. The Uppsala Antibiotic Center was just built when I finished my PhD thesis, and I was able to join them as coordinator. And within my work as coordinator, I was able to develop and grow much more in the topics of communications, and in particular, communication around antibiotic resistance and antimicrobial resistance. So I want to start this talk by highlighting and making a case of how communication can be such a powerful tool. And I want you to think that when we talk about communications, a lot of times it's about how you say things and what you're saying. So what you're saying is as important as how you are saying things. And I'm sorry, I have to share again because I think I didn't share my sound and I need to share my sound. So just 1 second. I will re-share my screen with share sound, and then we can play this video that I want you guys to pay attention to. Let's see if it plays. Can you hear it? Can you hear the video, Daniel?
Yes, it's playing. It's playing, Eva. Thank you.
you do to my sign?
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
You see this? This is what she wrote. He wrote first, "I'm blind, I need money," or something like this. And then she wrote, "It's a beautiful day and I can see it." I think this is a wonderful example of how we can convey the same information in two very different ways that have different results. The fact is that he's blind, that he cannot see, right? And what she did was to tell a story with the fact that he cannot see, to appeal to the people, to make the case of why is it so sad for him that he is blind, right? It's a beautiful day and I can see it. So this is an example of how powerful communication can be, in the way that not only what we say and how, but how we say it plays a role in this whole topic of communicating something to someone, right? I want now to actually get a little bit of your input, because I think that one of the ways that we learn the best is when we actually communicate with each other. It's bad enough that this is now online, that it's wonderful because I can be here with you from very different parts of the world and we can all be together in the same place, but it kind of lacks this interaction. So I'm trying to find a way that I can interact with you guys a little bit. And what I want now is for you to go to menti.com, and you are going to answer the question of why should we communicate about AMR. I want you to give me your reasons of why is it that you are today learning about communications on AMR, and why do you think that we should communicate on AMR? Because AMR is often seen as a rather complicated, biological, and inaccessible problem. So why do you think we should communicate about AMR? And you guys can go to menti.com and put the code that you are seeing there. I'm also going to put it in the chat so you guys can copy it. And I want you to just go ahead, go to menti.com, put that code and answer the question. And we're gonna start seeing your guys' answers in a moment. I'm gonna share what you guys are saying about this. Can you see the Menti results now? I hope.
Yes, they are going to
start showing up. All right.
Yeah.
I will wait a little bit and then see. 70 people here. Great. Thank you so much for joining us today. Lovely. I'm based in Sweden, by the way, so I'm a little bit more north than the majority of you, I believe. Is anybody has confirmed that they sent in some results, perhaps? Not yet. Okay, things are starting coming in. Good, just checking that it's working. All right, what are you guys saying about why to communicate about AMR? So someone reply, so everyone can realize how important it is and take action to mitigate and reduce it. That is an overall very big goal, but it is completely true. I agree with you. What else do we have? I'm sure you all guys have some ideas of why we should communicate, or maybe you actually have different reasons. I am very interested in knowing your own personal reasons of why would you like to communicate about AMR. Maybe you have a specific reason in mind, which is very important when we then later are going to talk about how to build up the communication efforts. Anybody else? To showcase why we need to take antibiotics rationally and in a relatable way. That is very nice, because that's a particular goal. So the goal with that communication in this case would be to only take antibiotics rationally to whoever is there talking about this. We need to communicate in order to help people under the meaning of AMR, to understand, I guess, the meaning of AMR and engage them in action. Nice. I think it's important because AMR hasn't a face, or it doesn't have a face. That's true. Communication is the only way we can truly start a conversation about it. This is very important, and the reason why the majority of the communication so far kind of haven't been super hyper mega successful, and it's because we are lacking that face that you're mentioning here. It will help to reduce drug resistance during treatments. That can be another option. So if people know about it, it is important to create awareness to the community, government, medical professionals, and other professionals, as well as stakeholders. This will shed light on the critical worldwide problem. To people that are answering like this, like it, it's important to create awareness. It's important to shed light. I would like you to, maybe not right now, but at some point, sit down and think a step further. Why is it important that we create awareness, right? Like, because yes, communicating can result in creating awareness, but why is it that we need this awareness around AMR? You don't need to answer now, but you just have in mind these questions. What else do you have here? Need to pass the message to even common people. I mean, an educator who doesn't know it's a silent pandemic. Yeah, people that have not been under, you know, the effects of it. Create awareness and, of course, be able to reduce death rate resulting from AMR. That's a very good goal, just to reduce how many people die of AMR every year. Knowledge is a step towards solving a problem. That is very, very good. Communication gives everyone a base knowledge. Yeah, communication gives power and agency to people to do or not do something about it, but with the knowledge behind it. So communication to share knowledge, that's good. You guys have really very good ideas. Thank you so much for sharing this with me. I'm actually gonna take these answers and also think about what is it that you guys are thinking when we talk about why to communicate AMR. I am going to now stop showing this and go back to my presentation here. If everything goes all right. Yes. Thank you so much for that, guys. Thank you for answering. And I want you to think that when we want to communicate about AMR, it's about what is it the result on the other end. We know that if we share knowledge, we can empower people. So have the public empower about the knowledge of what's happening out there. We can also drive public prioritization. That means if the public really thinks this is an important topic, it can put pressure into the policy agenda and change the policy actions. Also, when we change the way we talk about a problem, we can also drive policy action. And in general, the AMR community wants to be more present out there. They want to, you know, show that things are happening, that is a problem, and then we're looking for solutions actively. Just to go through some basic communications tips, what should we start considering when we sit down and we say, okay, we want to create a communication effort, a communication activity of whatever mode of or form it is, shape or form. What are the three things that you should be thinking on? First, you have to know your audience. Who are you gonna talk to? Who are you trying to reach with your communications? What is the goal with trying to reach that person? And what ways does it fit best to reach that particular audience that you want to reach? After that, you can start thinking about how to shape your angle. So what are you going to say? But not only what are you going to say, as we saw before, how are you going to say it? That's the angle of your communications. And I think here the strategic communication principles, which we are going to talk in a second, are very, very useful. And after that, and you have an angle, you know, the audience that you are going to be talking to, you have to kind of localize the story that you want to tell. And this is important because it's been shown that storytelling is a very powerful way of communicating. Stories are relatable. They become individualized pieces of information for people. And they're also much, much easier to be remembered. So if you want your communications to be last longing, you know, like they stay with the people for longer, basing them in stories that are relatable is a very, very, very good way. So what is strategic communication? Strategic communication is a way of communicating with purpose while showcasing the values that are present to achieve a particular goal. And this can be applied to many different areas. It doesn't have to be only science communication or communication around AMR, but I think strategic communication, when we're trying to communicate to have a goal with that communication, be it whatever it is, the principles of strategic communication can be really important. And the main principles of this kind of communication is first identify the goal. So what do you want your audience to do? It's kind of like looking from the bottom up, so the other way around. So after if your communication is successful, what is it that you want the result to be, whatever it is? So identify the goal. Then you go ahead and you understand your audience. What are your audience's values? What are their needs? What is their background? How do the needs that they have align with your own needs as a communicator? What is it that you want to communicate? What are your needs as communicator? What are their needs? And then you can align those things and, you know, have a communication that is beneficial for both parties, the person that communicates and the person that the communication is kind of falling into. So you tell them why their action in response to the communication is needed. So you make them be a team player on whatever is happening between the communication and the communicate. I don't know if you can call it like this, but yeah, who is in one side and the other side. And then a couple of things about the target audience, because I think one of the main issues or things that are difficult when we talk about AMR communications, and it's been brought up over and over again, is that you need to be careful because you need to work with your communication around your target audience, because not all target audiences are going to be exactly the same. So you can start asking your questions like this. You can start, who am I going to be speaking to? As before we were saying, you are going to know who is your target audience depending on what kind of result you want from the communication. And once you have your target audience, you start asking questions about this particular group. Who are those people I'm going to talk to? What is their role, or what are their roles in the society or in the world around? Why is it them that you are trying to reach to? You know, why is it particularly them that you are going to talk to about this particular issue? And sometimes just saying is the general public is not enough. General public is very undefined. It's very big. Who is general public? We are all general public in some sense or another, right? So if you can kind of zoom in a little bit more and find more defined description of who is your target audience, it would help you much, much more to have very effective and targeted communications. So I'm giving you here some examples of some different groups that can be target audiences. And underneath each group, I wrote an example. It's just an example. It doesn't have to be this per se, of why would it be that you are reaching out that particular group. So for example, if we have healthcare professionals, maybe you are communicating to them because you want to implement change in prescription patterns for whatever reason. When you talk to public health professionals, maybe what you are trying to is increasing the epidemiology tracking, right? Because they have the power to increase or reduce the epidemiology efforts or surveillance as well. If you talk to AMR professionals in general, maybe what you are hoping for with that communication is to increase cross-sectorial collaborations. You are trying to find collaborators in a particular issue. If you are talking to consumers, perhaps what you want as a net result is that they only buy raised without antibiotics meat, if that is something that is available, or any other kind of behavior that you want from the consumers. If you are talking to politicians, maybe what you are looking for is that they support policies to increase stewardship in their particular region, for example. And if you're talking to patients, perhaps what you're trying to do is that they understand that they should not ask for antibiotics to reduce the burden on the prescriber when the patients go and to seek healthcare, right? So all of this to say that it's not that I don't want to make the case that, you know, knowledge for the sake of knowledge is not important. It is very important. And all these changes in behavior and all these changes in how someone acts around a topic, they come from having the knowledge about it. But generally, when we communicate, there is a reason behind it. So for example, I'm today here talking to you about this. I am sharing my knowledge with you so you can also have partake of that knowledge. But the overall goal in the end is not just that you learn about this, it's that you will go ahead and you would implement some of these ideas into your own communications that will turn out into be successful communications, right? So there's always a reason why we are communicating something. I hope that this is just good examples that can be relatable somehow in your contexts as well, which I'm not sure. If you have questions, for sure, go ahead and ask questions as we're going along. All right. So what are the ways to communicate? Because once you have decided, okay, there is a certain group consumers of this supermarket, whatever, this is a group I want to reach out to. Then you have to think about how can I reach out to this particular group, right? And this is, it will again have a lot of basis on knowing your audience. If you can see a repetition and a pattern here, knowing your audience is the ultimate best thing that you can do to have optimal communications. But once you know who you want to talk to, then you have to think, okay, how am I going to do it? You have to analyze your audience behaviors and patterns so you can learn how do they relate with different kind of media, knowledge acquisition, etc. You have to choose them for them the right channel to undergo this kind of communication effort. And then you have to prepare the right material given that you want to reach that particular audience through that particular channel. You go ahead and you, with the means you have, create the material for that communication. I'm gonna give you a couple of examples of different ways of communicating, of things that are not what I have worked on, but things that are available around the world when it comes to AMR communication. If you decide that your audience is more attuned or probably is gonna gather their information by reading something and accessing data or information by themselves, you can go ahead and you can prepare and work with toolboxes. Like, for example, we have here the toolbox of React that is very, very complete and very very good in their website. You can also build full websites that are just for people to go on and get information. Like, I'm giving you here the example of the website of the World Health Organization around the World Antimicrobial Awareness Week, which is coming up now in November. So maybe after this talk today, you decide to make a particular communication activity for that particular week in November. You can also prepare infographics like this one here to the left with the growing resistance to last line antibiotics. And you can have pamphlets that are communicating a particular information that you want. The difference between infographics and pamphlets tends to be that infographics is more about graphs, as you can see here a lot. It's a lot, not a lot of text, and it's very kind of like catchy to the eye about the information they want to convey. And pamphlets can be more comprehensive. Generally, they tend to be printed and put it out in places or given out. Like, these are ways that people can access information through reading something. Then we have the people or the target audience that might be able to access the information easier by listening or by being in listening environments, or maybe they like videos, or maybe they like podcasts, for example. So here we have an example of another podcast, which is not a podcast. We'll talk about it a little bit later. Tales of the Resistance. Here we have Vanessa Carter, that I don't know if you have seen any talks by her, but she's a public speaker telling her story with resistance, which is very powerful. So she goes in conferences and talks about her issues. She's also been in our podcast as well. And then you can also have access to videos that talk about the problem of antibiotic resistance from many different angles. You can make videos. You can either make videos that are based on interviews, like here with the Dr. John Rex and with Anna Govet, that many of you are also familiar with. Or you can make videos that are like the one we were seeing before we started this talk, or the one about antibiotic resistance in general by React. They can be powerful ways of communication as well. And then you can also try to find a way to converse with the people, to communicate by conversing, either in groups or one-to-one, which can be very powerful. And for conversing, if you're thinking you can reach your target group with this kind of activities, you could set up outreach activities. That's the more typical activity where you set up a station somewhere in a science fair or in like some conference or in a museum or somewhere where people are going to be walking around, and they might come and talk to you, and then you can tell them about what is it that you want to tell them about and them to learn. Or you can set up focus groups. For example, this has worked very nicely with health professionals when they wanted to implement some changes in stewardship, for example. Then the communication is shared with these health professionals in focus groups where people can have discussions about the information and the things that need to be changed. And you can also have, to a certain degree, some sort of conversation with people in social media as well. Social media can also be just like a megaphone to put things out there, but it allows you for this interaction and this conversation one-to-one with other people, which is very nice. Now we are going to change a little bit topics. So we talked about things that are very, very general on communications. Everything that I said to you before, it can be applied almost to any kind of communication. It doesn't have to be only the AMR, but I think it's important to know the basics, because when we are being trained to be researchers, like some of you, or public health professionals, or anything where we are going to have to talk to people, having clear what are the basics of communication and how can we be better communicators, I think it's really important to do a good job. So do you guys have any questions about this first part where we talk about general things? Not really? Then I think we're gonna go ahead and we talked a little bit about the reframing resistance report done by Wellcome, based on research done by Wellcome and published in 2019. Yes, Zakaria, do you have a question? Please open your mic and ask ahead.
Okay, thank you very much for giving me the permission to speak. My name is Zakaria Ododa. I am a medical laboratory science student from Uppsala University here in Nigeria. My question is, I think a few months ago, me and a colleague of mine went to do an outreach to talk to young schoolers about antimicrobial resistance. So I want to ask, what is the most effective way to talk to children about antimicrobial resistance, children that are not conversant with basic sciences like resistance, what are microbes, and the like that. Very young students. Yeah.
I will leave your question for the almost last part of the talk, because I will talk about specific things that we did at the Uppsala Antibiotic Center, and some of those are talking to young children. So I'll talk about specifics of how we do it and set up these activities when we get to the end. But it's a very, very nice question, Zakaria. So we're going to talk about that. Irada, do you have a question? You put your hand up, but if you can open up your mic and say your question if you want, Iradat. I don't know if I'm pronouncing your name right, but if not, then you can also write it in the chat or leave it for the end of the session as well. That's, we'll have some time for questions. All right, so we're gonna continue with the reframing resistance research, the Wellcome. I will also leave the link, sorry, I cannot apparently copy and paste and talk at the same time. I didn't realize until today, but I'll send the link here for the report at the Wellcome as well. So they went ahead and did a very comprehensive research looking into how can we talk better about antimicrobial resistance if it's that we are not talking well enough already, with a particular goal, which was to increase public comprehension of resistance, but at the same time persuade and show to the public that AMR is an issue that is worthy of political action ultimately. So they looked at, can we find better ways to talk about AMR that increase the knowledge about resistance in general in the population, and it can tell them and prove that the AMR is worthy of political action. So when we talk about framing, in generally, what we're saying is that this thing of the what you're talking versus how you're talking about it is, can we present facts that we know are true and present them in a particular way that does makes the audience process the information and have a reaction to that information that is being processed? So that's what we talk when we say like about framing. And what they went ahead with this report was to look first is like, are there any issues with the way we communicate about AMR currently in the media and in social media? And what they saw was three main problems, and I completely fully agree with them. Problem number one is that we generally use a lot of different terms. You probably, many of you have heard these and even more terms being thrown out when talking about AMR and antibiotic resistance. You can say antibiotic resistance, antimicrobial resistance, AMR, superbugs, superbacteria, germs, microbes, drugs, medicine, antibiotics. This is confusing. It's a lot of things that for professionals, yeah, it's easy to know the differences, you know, between an antimicrobial and antibiotic, but not everybody knows about that. Or what's the difference between a germ and a microbe, or an antibiotic and an antifungal, or AMR and antibiotic resistance? Is it the same? All these things create confusion, create way too many things to have to analyze and put together. They also saw that we talk about AMR in many multiple frames, and that is not helpful. Some pieces of news and social media communications talk about AMR as having economic impact, other about AMR targeting specific diseases, AMR in the frame of how many numbers of deaths there are of it. Sometimes we talk about it being a biological issue, other times talking about it being a human issue, other times it's actually an animal issue because it's only because we use antibiotics in the animals. Other times we talk about marker failure when it comes to new antibiotics. And can you imagine if you really don't know, you're not a professional in this topic, how confusing this becomes. Some people are telling me that a lot of people are dying. Other people are telling me that it's the markets that are failing us. How do people put all these things together? It's not helpful to talk about this in many very different framings. And they also saw that AMR discourse is generally an specialist conversation. It is not a mainstream issue as compared, for example, with global climate change. And it's mostly a conversation between experts in social media and the general media. There's not a lot of movement between just not associated people to AMR or the healthcare sector talking about AMR that could, you know, it's a problem, like it could be global warming or climate change. So these were the three main issues that they saw. And what they came up with was five principles to be applied to create the most effective communications around AMR. In brief, the principles are: number one, frame AMR as undermining modern medicine. Number two, explain, don't lecture or blame. Number three, emphasize that this is a universal issue affecting everyone, including you, the person you are communicating to. Number four, focus on the here and now. And number five, encourage immediate action. So we can talk a little bit about each one of them because I want you to really understand what they mean. But these are the main principles that you should have in mind when you are going to talk about AMR in general. And that could be helpful, at least. So number one, frame AMR as undermining modern medicine. That helps us to have a common frame on the communications. You don't have to talk about specific diseases. You can just talk about how AMR is threatening the modern medicines we know it today. It can set medicine back in time. And you can also tailor this particularly perhaps to some audiences. So if you are talking to cancer patients, for example, you can talk about how cancer patients are more at risk of contracting infections. And if we cannot treat the infections, then this is a problem. So then you are talking about how antibiotic resistance or antimicrobial resistance is affecting the odds of cancer patients to have a proper treatment completed, for example. The number two, we have explained, don't lecture or blame. So you have to use clear, succinct, and easy to understand language. You don't patronize your audience and you make them understand things in easy terms, but you have to explain things. You cannot just lecture them with complicated things or blame them because they might not know. So it's also good here to think about the fact that a lot of people think that the body becomes resistant to antibiotics and not the bacteria that comes resistant, because we're saying that's something that happened to us. And that can be a problem, because if they think that is something that happened to them, if they behave a particular way, then they don't have to worry about the rest of the people around. But as we know, you know, bacteria are the ones that become resistant, and bacteria are shared between people and bacteria travel. So we have to be careful about resistance because we are all in a community and it's part of everyone, which brings us to a later principle as well. Then you have the number three, emphasize that this is a universal issue affecting everyone, including you. So you want to communicate in relatable terms, and you want to communicate in a way that brings people together. Generally, it's been seen that numbers do not work very well. We are not very good at estimating numbers and what they mean. And it's better to have an approach that focuses on the impact to the individuals. And this is a little bit how the storytelling can come into play as well, because you are telling about story, you are making them realize that they can be protagonists of a story like that, for example. So it can affect everybody, including, you know, you, the person that is listening to this. Number four, we have the focus on the here and the now. Generally, the research show that avoiding clickbait terms like apocalypse is a good thing. Apocalypse doesn't really work very well. Apocalypse is something that it gives fatigue. You know, people get stressed of thinking of like really bad outcomes in the future, but also doesn't work because we're talking about something that will happen perhaps in the future, you know, and we are not really good at putting ourselves in the shoes of a future generation, so to speak. Do not use projections. We all know about the O'Neill report and the 50 million or 10 million of deaths a year by 2050, more than cancer, etc. That doesn't really work with people. Using projections doesn't really convey that the problem is already here, is already killing people every year. So don't use projections in the future, use data about what's happening now. And if you can avoid using numbers, as we said before, better than anything. And also talk about how the current impact, which is important, is actually getting worse. So talk in present, don't talk in future terms, all right? This is important. And then the last but not least, encourage immediate action. And this is because, as we were saying at the beginning, you want to have an action with the communication. Generally, if you are just here to listen and not do anything about what you listen to, there are more chances that you are going to forget about it. So frame it as a solvable issue and be clear with the specific actions that you want your audience to take. It might be from simple as go home and tell this to your family that weren't here today. Or it could be vote for politicians, if you can, that have this in their agenda. It could be next time you have a sore throat, don't ask for an antibiotic. Or it could be wash your hands so we avoid sharing bacteria with each other. It could be anything, but frame it as a solvable issue that can be achieved by the small actions that your audience is going to be able to take on. So you can really give them agency and have a result from your communication. It's 42:02. I'm not sure we have a lot of time, but I'm going to leave you here. We won't work on it together also because you guys are 80 people and I kind of expected to be less people. And I thought maybe we can do a small focus groups to talk about this. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to share a link with you. And that is a video about the WHO. And later, maybe after I finish or maybe tomorrow, you can go and play the video. It's only 1.5 minutes. And I want you to think about how do the 5 principles that we talked about from the reframing resistance report from the welcome apply to this video? Are all the principles apply? Can more principles be applied? Or maybe some of the principles should be changed the way they're applied? Or would you at all change anything? Would you do something different on this video, which is a communication effort, based on the things that you learned today? Maybe, maybe not. I'm going to leave you in the chat the link, and I also will give it to Daniel that is gonna share my presentation later. So you are going to be able to maybe do this exercise by yourself or with some friends as well. We go to the next thing though. And now to end the presentation, I wanna talk about the examples from the Uppsala Antibiotic Center. The Uppsala Antibiotic Center is a center for multidisciplinary research, education, and awareness on AMR based at the Uppsala University here in Sweden, where I'm based on. I'm originally from Spain though, but I've been here for the past 10 years. And as I said, I always loved science communication and communications in general. And when I joined the center, I said, look, I think a center like this has the responsibility to work on communications on these issues because our center is based on PhD students and principal investigators that are researching around AMR in very many different topics. But even though we are teaching them at the university, I think we can reach out beyond, you know, these people at our center in the university. And that's how we came up with a series of communications activities that are divided in outreach events, the podcast, which is my dear communication activity that I work on it almost every day, and awareness materials for certain times of the year as well. And I'm gonna just show you a little bit what we do. When it comes to outreach events, we go out to all the scientific fairs that we can, and we also go to all the schools that we can around the area. Here you can see my colleague Jenny is showing some photos of bacterial, of the microbiota of our body to talk about bacteria with the kids. And someone, Zakaria, was asking first, how do you talk to kids about this? Because yeah, I agree, resistance is very complex and it's something that they won't really understand unless you put them in the mindset of like, why should they even care that bacteria? So what we do is to actually tell a story in the activity that we have. We go from the fact that bacteria are everywhere because we don't want them to be scared of bacteria. And we tell them, like, reflect about themselves. Do you know what bacteria are? Do you know where they live? Do they live on you? Do they live in you? And we show them pictures. So then they feel the connection with the bacteria first. And then after that, we tell them, is there all bacteria good? Or do you think all bacteria are bad? What do you think? And then some, they will say they're all bad, or no, majority are good, depending on their age, they will tell you what they know. And then you make them understand that the majority of bacteria are actually good. They don't really create any problems. But sometimes you do have some bacteria that go rogue and they create infections, and then it's where people are sick. And then you ask them, so what do you do if someone is sick? So then you get them into the conversation of, oh, you treat them. What do you treat them with? Then you talk about antibiotics. And then is when you get to the point that you say, okay, did you know that sometimes antibiotics don't work? And then you engage them by asking questions all the time. So if the antibiotics don't work, do you think this is a good thing? Or do you think this is a bad thing? And then they will say, maybe we'll say it's good. And then you will ask them why. So you have to kind of make them think a little bit in order for them to engage in the information that you are trying to convey to them. And it works really nicely. And another thing that we have done is to develop a tabletop game to teach them concepts of evolution, because resistance, yeah, at its core, it's an evolutionary concept, right? Like, why do resistance accumulate? And it's because there is an evolution, there's selection for resistance, and then it basically gets selected for. So we have done that by creating a tabletop game where they use dice and beans of different colors to show that if you have a mixed population of resistant and sensitive bacteria, the resistant bacteria will accumulate and can be shared between people. So it's very few concepts that we teach there, but it kind of works more or less. Okay. So that's the activities we have done around outreach events. As Daniel was mentioning, and I said, I'm very proud of our podcast, the AMR Studio is the first, and now not the only, but it was the first solely dedicated podcast to AMR in the world, in English at least. And this came out of an idea of a different kind of communication effort, because at the center, we were bringing all these wonderful researchers and AMR professionals to teach our own students at the center. And then I thought, you know, there is also other professionals of AMR out there that might want to get inspired by the personal stories of these AMR researchers. How come that there is a lawyer that is studying or working within AMR? How did this historian ended up working with AMR related issues? This medical doctor, what are their experiences with AMR? So the goal of the AMR Studio as a communication effort was to increase awareness of other people's perspectives and viewpoints on AMR in the bigger sphere of the AMR research or professional efforts. It could doesn't have to be research, it could be also health professionals that are prescribing, or it could be other kind of professionals that work within the area, like public health officials, etc. So the goal of this activity is to bring awareness and find collaborations between people that work in different disciplines, because we really believe that only sustainable solutions to AMR are gonna come from people from different disciplines understanding each other and working together. So that was kind of the goal of this communication activity that we work on. And then we also prepare awareness material, especially for the World Antimicrobial Awareness Week. For the last year, we prepare a fact sheet that we share in our website. We created a website as well with the fact sheet and some other information about our university. And we had this fact sheet that was two-sided, one with like, what do you know about AMR? Like, did you know that blah, blah, blah? So kind of like testing their knowledge. And the other one with action. So how can you help slow AMR? And our target audience for this was actually everyone at the university that is not really working with AMR. So we're university students, university teachers, lecturers, researchers, etc. So it was targeted to people that are already in the academic environment, and that's what we decided to go from the angle of, did you know that? Because generally these people are very keen on testing their knowledge about things. So we thought that that was a nice hook for them to maybe engage in the material as well. And with this, I just want to finish up this talk by giving you 4 points to take home. If you just fell asleep, please wake up right now and just see this, this slide, which is, if you're gonna set up a communication effort around AMR, any kind, you say, okay, I want to talk about AMR. First, you have to think about your audience. Who are you gonna talk to? Analyze, learn, and know your audience thoroughly. Then think about, what is it that I'm trying to achieve with this communication? Do I have to communicate at all? So what do you want to achieve with this communication effort? After that, you can go ahead and select your channel and the media that you are going to have to work on to communicate the right way. And finally, but not least important, once you have the channel, the audience, the goals, think about how you're going to frame the communications. Frame the information in a way that makes your audience consider the facts that you are giving them and take action. And with that, I would like to thank you so much for the opportunity to talk to you today. It's the first time that I talk about this issue. So if I haven't been very clear on some things, we have now 10 minutes to talk about some clarifications, but I'm really happy that I was able to share a little bit of the knowledge that I acquired over the past 5 years in this topic. And I look forward to keep on the conversation with you and all learning from each other. Thank you so, so much.
Thank you, thank you, thank you so much, Eva, for that really, I think, very wonderful presentation. I think it has really brought us down to the key aspects and what we need to consider when communicating. And I think it's a key take home for us, especially because now we are nearing the World Week and the team will be engaging in some projects, some small activities during World Week. So I think this is a key point of consideration. At this juncture, I'd just love to open the floor to anyone with a question. You can just raise your hand and you can shoot it. Before then, I had seen a question in the chat, and this was, we've discussed a bit about the young children. So I'd seen a question asking, what about for university students? What's the best way to communicate with them? And maybe those ones, I think, who are not within you know, the healthcare confines of pursuing courses in biology and the rest.
I think for the university students, you have to kind of get them in their environment. You know, university students tend to be very busy. They have a lot of different courses, classes. So if you're trying to talk about AMR with people that are already in some of healthcare maybe programs, then you can talk to the teachers and say, do you have time in one of your lectures where I can come and talk about this particular issue? Or you can talk to the teachers to see, do you have already some part of your program where you talk about antibiotic resistance? And they might tell you yes, or maybe like, no, then maybe you can kind of tell them, oh, then could you spare half an hour in one of your classes where I come and talk about this, and you can run the material by them, for example. If it's to university students that are not related to the healthcare field and they are many other different programs, I think maybe creating an outreach activity in a cafeteria, for example, or an area where you know there's going to be a lot of traffic of university students could be a good option. So you can just maybe create an activity that is just showing them whatever it is that you want to actually to tell them. If you want to tell them just about AMR, just resistance, you know, resistance exists. Maybe you can bring some plates or something from the lab if you have access, or you can bring infographics that are already available or that you make yourself, or you can just bring three people and you put a box and you sit on top of the box and you say, I want to talk to you today about this particular issue, sort of thing. That really depends if you think that that will actually work in a particular campus. But things like this, all of this that I'm telling you, I have seen them being done as science communication efforts in universities in different occasions around Europe in particular. So if you can do something like this.
Thank you so much. I hope, Nick, your question is answered. I was referring to your question. We can move over to Iradat. Over to you, Iradat. Maybe you can unmute and ask your question now.
Okay, thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, I can hear you, yes.
Okay, thank you. My question is concerning the storytelling. You said storytelling can be used as a tool for communicating. So how can we improve on storytelling, or how can you make sure that the story you're going to be telling your audience can relate to it and understand what you're trying to communicate with them?
Well, I think for that, you need to know your audience. Like, for example, if you are talking to an audience that the majority, you know, they might have kids, maybe you can talk with the stories about how AMR might affect babies. You know, that way, you know, they might feel relatable because they all have kids and they all know what it is to have a sick child at home, right? And those is telling the story of a sick child, to use it as an example of what is it that you want to tell, might be a powerful storytelling approach for that particular audience. That, for example, wouldn't work for teenage kids, for example. If you're going to talk about older people, you can talk about the old cancer patient that cannot, or, you know, it has to be in a way. That's why I said knowing your audience is very important, and tailoring your audience as narrow as possible also helps you a lot, because you can find stories that can be relatable to that particular audience that you want to talk to. So if it's university students, you can talk about the university student that didn't know that traveling to another country could mean bringing resistant bacteria back. Things like this, that they can see themselves in the situation that you are talking about. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Radat. I hope it's clear. Maybe we can go to Teles4 and then Adrian.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. So thank you for, first of all, for a good presentation. So I've seen that up to now, many strategies have been put into place to curb this problem of antimicrobial resistance. Even the current research has proved that by 2050, the 10 million of people will be dying every year due to this problem of antimicrobial resistance. So I was asking myself, you as an expert, what do you think that this strategy of antimicrobial resistance communication will reduce to this problem of antimicrobial resistance? And you think that when this communication is strengthened, it will reduce that level to which that the research has proved that by 2050, the numbers will be highly increasing and many people will be dying. Thanks.
So you are asking me, see if I got your answer, your question correctly. You're asking me what overall I think is the most a useful communication strategy, or would that be? Is that what you were asking?
So I was asking that, you know, when this strategy of communication is strengthened, especially here in Africa, do you think that this rising problem of antimicrobial resistance, you know, to which extent do you think that it will reduce this problem of antimicrobial resistance?
One single communication effort and a strategy, I don't think it's enough to actually get to a sustainable place. And I come back to this idea of the Uppsala Antibiotic Center and why we're working multidisciplinarity and the podcast. I think different fronts need to be tackled at the same time to get to a place where it's better. And different parts of Africa are going to have different needs as well. So it has to be based on the particular needs of a particular country or region. Is it because there is not enough antibiotics to the right antibiotics to be used. Then the communication should be focused on who can provide the money for the antibiotics to be available, who can procure those antibiotics. Maybe we need to focus our communication efforts in that particular sector and topic in that particular region. Whereas in another region, maybe we need to talk about, we have a way too many number of non-prescribed antibiotics being dispensed. Then maybe we need to have communication efforts that first strengthen the policy and the laws to prevent the selling of non-prescribed antibiotics. And then we can use communication efforts to teach the people that they should not be looking for antibiotics without the prescription because they actually don't need them. So I don't see that there's one holy grail silver bullet in terms of communication that is going to really have a big effect. I think it has to be really tailored on specific goals for specific regions and specific audiences. And that's also why it's so difficult, right? There's no one thing that if we work on it, everything is going to be solved. That would be great. It's more about what works where and how and when do we do it, which, yeah, it is hard. I agree with you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Adrian?
Thank you. First of all, thank you for a wonderful presentation. I'd like to ask the question regarding communication. Communication is good to mitigate antimicrobial resistance. However, about communication, we still have barriers, for example, language barrier. Because many countries are not using their native language, and you know that most of you people in the country are not aware of using, for example, English language. So what can be done to facilitate the all citizens of African, especially sub-Saharan, because it is where there is greatest risk of this antimicrobial resistance, so that every people can be able to easily to get those information in their native language. So it can help to mitigate this issue because you can read everywhere you are. Thank you.
Yeah, you are completely right, Adrian. It's something that I didn't really address on my talk for the sake of time. We were all here talking in English. But when we're talking about your audience, that's part of it. What is your audience? Is your audience going to be able to understand what you're telling them in English? And more than that, is your audience going to be able to understand what you're saying in their own language? Because you have to have then collaboration with people that really understand how the audience uses the language, for them to understand exactly what you want them to understand and to take the actions that you think they need to take. So it's beyond language. It's like, does it work for that particular group? So obviously for different countries around the world, different countries in Africa, if you wanna reach the people that, you know, they don't have English as a working language or as a second language, you will have to do these communications efforts in the particular language of interest, for sure. So I hope that there can be some help there. You can maybe use some principles from these and then apply them into your language. And also another thing is that when you see, for example, WHO, you know, strategy plans or action plans, you need to see what things do they work in the different regions. It's not the same thing in one country and another country. So all that need to be tailored to the particular audience and region as well. Yeah. Thank you, Adrian.
Thank you, too.
Daniel, do we have more time?
Yes. Okay. I think we are short of time now. But do you have, I think we can just, because I can see just two, maybe, are you okay with us?
Sure. I have to be gone by 7:15 because I have another meeting, okay. But until then I can stay, yeah.
Okay, so I think we can just take quickly these two, then we end. Yeah. Dion, maybe you can ask your question quickly, please, so that we release Eva.
Okay, thank you. Eva, I heard you talked about the outreach events regarding to kids. So I was thinking that maybe during the Antimicrobial Awareness Week, we can maybe hold school campaigns in primary schools. So what other ways do you suggest that we can put the message across to kids who are still in primary and those who are still in preschool?
I think one thing that really works for me when I try to do things with the kids is to do it via their teachers. So I try to connect with their teachers first. I understand what things they have been talking about in class about different topics. So I always, the messages and the things I prepare for the kids is based on the things they have been recently been talking about in school, because that helps them have something relatable. So that's a way. I will talk to the teachers first, see what is it that they've been talking recently, and then you can talk to them about the World Antimicrobial Awareness Week to the teachers. So this is important, and I would like to come to your school to talk about this during that week. Maybe you can do 2 classes per day in 7 days, 5 days of the week. You can reach out all like 10 classes, which would be really nice, and then it would be a part of the World Antimicrobial Awareness Week campaign. But I would say go through the teachers first. It will help.
Thank you. Thanks so much, Eva. Maybe Zakia, the last question now, can unmute and ask your question.
Okay. Thank you very much for.
Yes, Zakia.
Thank you.
I hear you very, very low. Can you come closer to the mic or something?
Okay.
I think we lost Zakia.
Maybe a bit. Sorry.
Okay. Maybe Zakaria, were you saying something? As we wait for Zakia, then we wind up if she's not able to join.
Okay. I wanted to ask earlier, regarding to storytelling and antimicrobial resistance. What I notice is that most of the stories about antimicrobial resistance are alarming stories, stories that tells you that there are problems if you don't take actions, stories that you know that, okay, if I don't stop abusing these drugs, I might end up in resistance to those drugs. And one of the other side of the story is that we our audience tend to understand that the resistance in some cases is evolutionary, it occurs naturally. So how do you kind of give our audience a kind of safer view, in the sense that they have their mind at peace, in the sense that they won't feel like, okay, even if I should abuse these drugs and I don't abuse this drug, in the long run, there are still chances that I might come up with antimicrobial resistance, since antimicrobial resistance is evolutionary, it's mutation and like that. I think that's my question.
That is a good point that you're bringing up about the randomness of life, right? Like, even if we are in the best of the situation, even if one person never takes antibiotics in their whole life, they might end up with a resistant infection. That is completely true. That's why you have to frame the communications about this being a global issue that is not just frame around individuals in the terms of who is going to be suffering from this. Anybody at any point can suffer from this. Hence, we all have to work together to reduce the chances that this might happen. But the same as, you know, let's say using seatbelts when you are going on your car, right? For example, you use seatbelts to reduce the chances that if you go into an accident, something bad is going to happen to you. But accidents will still happen, right? Probably. And maybe even if you have your seatbelt, you might have an accident where something very bad will happen to you. But this is a little bit similar. It's like things might happen, you know, but how can we reduce the chances that if you get an infection, it's not a resistant infection? And that's by all of us taking action on this together. So I think maybe you can try to frame it in that way, that even, we all together are behaving properly in this. For example, don't taking antibiotics more than we need, don't purchase them without antibiotics, et cetera, without a prescription, et cetera, then we reduce the chances that we might get a resistant infection or someone else might get a resistant infection. That might help, but I agree with you that it's not easy. And you know, life, it's random. Things might happen even if you do the best you can on something.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I can see time has really run. We don't want you to delay for your next appointment. Maybe Zakia, are you able to ask, or maybe you can maybe just unmute? If it's difficult, then I think you can just step in, we'll share it with Eva.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think, is that okay, Eva?
Yeah, all good. Again, thank you so much for inviting me. I hope that you guys have a nice hour and that you have a wonderful day ahead, all of you.
Thank you so much. And we do appreciate a lot that you made it. And oh, it has really been an amazing session. And I can't wait to see how much people do about this during the week. Thank you so much and have a wonderful evening all.
Great. Let's connect on the interwebs and social media and so on, so we can keep a track of what we're working with. Thank you again, everybody. Have a wonderful night. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.